I'm Bob Gilligan with the Catholic Conference of Illinois. We represent the Catholic bishops at the state capitol in Springfield, and today we're here to talk about Senate Bill 3499, which enacts assisted suicide in the state of Illinois.
I'm Father Peter Harmon, a priest of the Diocese of Springfield in Illinois, currently assigned at St. Anthony of Padua in Effingham, and I have a background in moral theology and work often with the Catholic Conference of Illinois.
Father Christopher Trummer, I'm the parochial vicar here at St. Agnes in Springfield, and also have a background in moral theology, so here to discuss this really important topic today.
It is an important topic. We have a bit of a problem. Senate Bill 3499 was just introduced. It was introduced by State Senator Linda Holmes from the Plainfield area. And the bill is starting to pick up some support. We're seeing some media attention now on it. And so what we wanted to do today is to talk a little bit about the problems and challenges with the bill. Like I said, it just got introduced recently. We have been preparing for this legislation for quite a while. So everything we're going to talk about today, you can refer to the information that's been prepared for further details. And you can go to www.ilcatholic.org for further information. So the bill itself, it's modeled on legislation in other states. In essence, what it does is it allows a physician, upon an oral request by an individual, to examine that individual to make sure that they are competent. And if they're competent, that person can go to another physician. And if that physician determines they're competent, they would be eligible to have pills, a lethal dosage of pills, either mailed to their house or picked up at a pharmacy in order to end their life. So there's many problems with this legislation, but in a nutshell, that's what the bill does without going into many of the details. This creates a lot of moral, ethical problems for not only, for mostly for society, but also to individuals in the medical profession. Father Harmon, you want to pick up any other problems you see with this bill?
Yeah, thanks, Bob, and thanks for your work with the state of Illinois and the Catholic Diocese to be a vocal and organized presence against the passage of this bill. We'll talk today a little bit about some of the moral and societal and even financial worries that this bill, if it were to be passed, would bring. I think a lot of people might be comfortable in saying, well, that's not something I would elect to do. And so therefore, if someone else finds themselves in a situation where they are suffering of a terminal illness, I really shouldn't be involved in that. There are several reasons why our faith tells us that's not an approach that we as Catholics or as Christians or we believe people of goodwill for the greater good of society would want to see developed. Part of our anthropology, of course, is that each of us is created in God's own image and likeness. We are redeemed by Christ's suffering and death, and that we belong to each other in the human community. Unlike other life forms or animals that you might euthanize or put out of their suffering, human beings have to live together, and we grow and learn from the experience of caring for each other, right? We often say, I wouldn't want to be a burden to someone, but what it means to raise children, what it means to be in a relationship, means to be with that person in good times and in their struggles and in their suffering. Other life forms, our pets, right, they don't build human communities. They don't care for each other in the same way. They don't have lifelong relationships. They act on instinct. The proponents of this legislation use some pretty catchy, but I believe inaccurate assessments. They talk about this as being a measure of compassion. And I believe that they kind of build up a false prognosis for someone who has died. This legislation would say to you that it's really compassionate to help someone end their suffering, and they're then painting a drastic picture of a person who receives a diagnosis from a physician about something very serious and then wants to end their suffering. They paint a person who is basically then without any other means to assist their suffering, even if they're not able to be healed. That's not the picture that the church teaches about end-of-life care. The church doesn't teach that we must do everything possible to extend our life by every treatment or every therapy or every medication or even take on things that would only extend our lives. Adequate pain management as well as the comfort care of hospice allows a person to be treated and to be recognized as an individual. Catholic Healthcare, who is the single largest non-government purveyor of healthcare in the country, and by far and away the people who do it for nonprofit, right? We recognize that the human person is made not just of a physical, but also has an emotional, a spiritual, and a relational dimension. Trying to advance the cause of assisted suicide, or what do they call
medical aid in dying,
removes everything from the human person except the physical. And the surveys will show that people whose pain and comfort can be addressed often rescind their request to be euthanized or to end their lives. So there's a lot of holes in this legislation where what is being proposed isn't what we think will actually happen were this bill to be enacted and it to become a part of our society. I believe Father Trummer can expound probably well on any number of those and concerns that we have in the church and in the larger community.
I was going to say, you know what's interesting about this is that I use the word compassion, and the major interest group that's pushing this across the entire country is called Compassion and Choices. They have spent tens of millions of dollars over the last 25 years to enact assisted suicide all across the country. Proponents will say, oh, it's already effective in 10 states. But you know, I think it's important to remember, in 40 states, it's not. And they spent a lot of money in a lot of states. So there's ways that we can oppose this. And I think what you are getting at a lot, Father Harmon, is about that compassion and pain argument. That really is the essence of our faith teaching, that you don't have to suffer. There's palliative care. One of the other reasons, Father Chris, maybe we should talk about this, as you started touching on this, Father Harmon, was that this coercion. The way the bill works, as I was saying at the intro, is somebody has pills mailed to their house. It's a lethal dosage of drugs. It sits there. They pick it up at the pharmacy. It sits there in their house. The doctor's involvement is over once they approve the person for the drugs. So the person may have decided not to take the pills. They may have changed their mind. There's nothing in this legislation that requires somebody else to be there to verify that they're not being coerced. How do we know that? There's nothing, no data requirement, there's no anything. There's a big element of, I think, a concern we have is, like, could somebody be coerced into doing something that they've changed their mind on?
You know, it's always a huge issue whenever you make something, you legalize something and people start to promote something, is that it creates what's perceived as a new way out of the suffering that in nature, with normal responsibility we have for one another, that option wouldn't even be there. So you not only create it as this, you know, maybe even some proponents or some people who are in favor of it being legalized think of it as some really super rare extreme case scenario, but then it starts to become kind of a mainstream approach to how you deal with suffering. I mean, think of like when abortion was first legalized, well, you know, this, oh, certain circumstances, very rare, this, you know, young person, this really challenging circumstances, and then it just becomes elective and it becomes like a widespread a way of approaching suffering. So one of my big concerns is with something like physician-assisted suicide is that the people who find themselves in those circumstances of suffering, they're literally at their most vulnerable point, where they stand to receive the greatest kind of human compassion, the greatest kind of solidarity, and the deepest affirmation of their dignity and of their value when they're at that lowest point. And instead of meeting them there in that lowest point, instead of doing the difficult work of accompanying them through that suffering or illness or whatever it is, the dying process, we're abandoning them to the suicidal thoughts, those desires to end the suffering, which are understandable psychologically. We're just leaving them alone with that and saying, well, we'll see where that takes you. And it's really abandoning them. I mean, St. John Paul II, in his encyclical in the 90s, Evangelium Vitae, the Gospel of Life, he talked about how just the definition of the word compassion, it means literally to suffer with. And to say that we're being compassionate when we withdraw from someone and give them some pills, I mean, it's frankly, it seems a little bit more sanitary, but it's kind of the equivalent of giving someone a gun or some other means of ending their life and saying, well, you know, whatever you desire. And that's true compassion goes beyond what someone might be demanding in the moment in their suffering, and it looks to their objective good, which is respecting their dignity.
And we're going to get more of it. I think what we've seen is there's a slippery slope argument here. In every state where this is passed, they'll say, oh, don't worry, you need two doctors. You have to wait, 5 days or 15 days. You have to digest the pills. They're not intravenous. It's only for people who are terminal and have a life expectancy of 6 months. In California today, there's legislation pending, and all across the country, every state is the same. Once they pass this, compassion and choices never goes away. They get stronger. And so now there's talk of increasing the time frame. Now it's not 6 months, let's make it a year. Now instead of digesting the pills, we'll allow people to use intravenous methods to kill themselves. Instead of a terminal illness of 6 months, let's make people eligible who have mid-level or severe cases of dementia.
And Bob, I think one of the things, again, even if you would find yourself saying, if you're still listening to us, I would never do that for a relative. I would not want to receive that myself. Instead, I'd rather be dealt with as a human being and have my pain, my emotional, my spiritual support, those needs met. I would not do that myself. But, and I don't want to sound sinister, but money plays a part in healthcare and insurance and in government assistance. And it would be very naive to think that in the future, if this passes, that decisions couldn't be made to not provide someone with care because their condition was deemed to be too expensive by the government or by their insurance provider. And your option is, well, because assisted suicide or medical aid in dying is available, that's what we're going to cover for you. I don't think it's too far of a cry or it's being too alarmist to say that could very easily be around the corner if that's a way in which we begin to deal in society with the reality
it's
of suffering.
It's happened.
I had two different patients and both needed life-saving procedures. When requesting a transfer to a center in their home states, one's in California, one's in Oregon, the insurance medical directors I spoke with said they would not cover the life-saving procedure that we'd requested. But hey, by the way, have you considered assisted suicide? Quite frankly, I was stunned. This is something we didn't talk about, we didn't request, we didn't ask for. As much as most insurance companies try to come across as your best friend, they want to do whatever the least costly thing is. It's a lot cheaper to grab a couple drugs and kill you than it is to provide you life-sustaining therapy. Simple as that.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of times people will use the phrase like slippery slope fallacy, but it's not necessarily a fallacy. It's just looking at the phenomenon of how things develop or degrade, morally speaking, in societies. It's not as if people with just purely evil intentions are going to come along and try to pass the most outlandishly, just diabolical. It's going to always seem, oh yeah, okay, that can kind of make sense, and it's incremental, and then it moves from one thing to the next. You start with purely requiring the consent of the patient, and then you move towards some of these cases, like you said, where people have dementia. Their consent is a little bit debatable, or it's in and out, and then you move into more and more cases where it's like, well, we're going to kind of move this person along through the dying process.
You're familiar with Canada,
absolutely, and yeah. let's not forget who always suffers in these situations, and it is the people with the least resources. So this legislation could easily be used for degrading the value of a person who suffers a disability,
right,
and the poor who would be the first to suffer if they don't want to make this decision. Again, I don't think it's alarmist or suspicious to think this would be around the corner if this were the way in which we dealt with a suffering member. And Father Chris made that beautiful analogy, right? So compassion is suffering with, euthanasia is dismissing the suffering person.
Every national disability organization that's taken a position on this legislation opposes it. That tells you the concern of the disability community. Guys, I don't know. We've pretty much covered most of it. Any other closing comments you want to make?
I would say that what can you do? I think that, suffering is something in our society where we have become, thanks be to God, so blessed to be able to alleviate. We suffer less, and thanks be to God. But we don't suffer well. And what leads to this impasse or this decision is that people suffer alone. And we're in pastoral care, we're familiar with being around suffering people and the noticing the difference when a family member or a friend visits them. Probably everyone listening or watching knows someone who is sick, mm-hmm. and it's easier to avoid that situation. We all, it's the natural tendency. Sure. That's what this legislation is about. It takes a supernatural grace to be present, but that's what the Lord calls us to do. We all know people for whom we can pray, for whom we can, to whom we can reach out, and we can say, your life, not only, but especially at this moment in your life, it matters. Your presence matter. Your presence matters. I'm with you. I don't want you to suffer right. alone. So even outside of this bill, to reach out to those who struggle and suffer, as difficult as that can be for us, it's the Christian response when we see that in our mm-hmm. midst.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, following the teachings of Jesus himself, like the church has the mission to look out for the dignity of the most vulnerable and those who are overlooked. So even as you said earlier, Father Harmon, even if people might be thinking, well, that I don't have any interest in that myself. I don't know anyone in my family or anyone I know that would desire assisted suicide. You know, we're part of a society, and you know, we live in this society, and we are responsible for furthering the cause of life, the cause of the gospel, especially as Christians. We have that mandate from the Lord. And so as part of our belonging to the church, we should be concerned for anything in society that is going against the direction of the dignity of the human person. And it will, whether it's tomorrow or in 5 years or in 10 years, it will really come close to home faster than we can believe.
So the Catholic bishops are putting out a statement. We hope by the time that this is posted on YouTube, it will be out. It's called A Better Way Forward, where the bishops recommend what Father Harmon was saying, hospice and palliative care. Let's reach out to the sick and the vulnerable among us, make them part of our family, that they don't feel alone and isolated, that there's a better path forward. And also for people that maybe they need more mental health care, behavioral health treatment, so they don't feel like they should be so burdened. So with that, if you want to go to www.ilcatholic.org, you can see not only that statement, but many other statements that we put out. There's a lovely Q&A that my colleagues here have put out, along with some talking points for clergy who are interested in learning more about this. There's some bulletin inserts. There's a novena. There's a prayer to St. Joseph. So we have a little bit of everything, hopefully, for any Catholic, any person of goodwill who wants to learn more, reflect more about this, and hopefully help you deal with, like Father Harmer's saying, situations in our own families. And we know there's a lot of poor people out there suffering. So with that, let's conclude our webcast. And thank you, everybody, for listening. And once again, you can go to www.ilcatholic.org for further information.